The boy made a strange confession. I've heard none stranger in all my days of the priesthood.
That doesn't surprise me.
After he made it, he wept. A deep and terrible weeping from the cellar of his soul. You feel better now, my son?
Yes, Padre.
Then he asked for you. You are not his father.
His father's dead. And his mother. Surely he told you that.
Yes.
You do believe him, don't you?
This is a dark thing. For Mark and for you. If it is true...
If it is true. Every word.
Maybe. But, Senor Mears, there were many words I did not understand. Mark's confession was fogged by terror. Since you left, have you had news of this new Jerusalem?
Jerusalem's lot. I get the local papers sent to me. They run stories from time to time. The lot's a ghost town. Mark, take it easy. There are rumors of devil worship, mass murder, UFOs, you name it.
But you know what really happened.
Yes.
Father, I told you what happened.
I know, my son. But it was hard to hear, even harder to believe. So I wish to have the story from other lips, too. Senor Mears.
I went back last September. Seems another lifetime now. Jerusalem's lot. Salem's lot.
Stephen King's Salem's Lot. Dramatized in 7 episodes by Gregory Evans. Episode 1.
I remember seeing the sign on the turnpike. Route 12, Jerusalem's lot. For a moment, I thought of driving by, but I guess I had nowhere else to go. So I turned off. After a few miles, Route 12 became Jointer Avenue. I took a detour along the Burns Road, where I'd lived as a kid, past the iron gates of Harney Hill Cemetery, then up the hill towards the Marston House. When I first saw it again, looking down over the town, I shivered. Even so, I couldn't resist it. Just had to take a look.
Hey, mister! I hope you're not contemplating going further.
Why not?
This is private land.
Oh, it always was, but as I recall, no one seemed to pay much mind.
That's so? Well, they do now. It seems like you've been here before.
Yeah, I used to live in the lot, years ago. Ben Mears.
Larry Crockett, real estate.
How do you do? Yeah, I'll be staying a while. Need a place to live. I don't suppose...
The Marsden House?
Yeah.
Look at it, Ben. Who'd live in that? You'd never sleep nights.
Well, it's in a good position.
Yeah, it's not for rent. It's just been sold.
Sold? You're kidding. Who bought it?
Look, Ben, here's... my car.
Oh, thanks.
I've got an office on Joyner Avenue. Call in, and maybe I can fix you up.
I turned from the Marsden House and drove down the hill into town. It was a few days later that I saw the girl watching me. I was sitting on a bench in the park. She was nearby, in the shade of a gnarled old elm, reading a book. She kept glancing up.
I usually don't speak to strange women, but, do we know each other?
No, I mean, that is,
It's just that, you've been looking at me for 15 minutes now, and, well, it's very flattering.
You're Benjamin Mears, right?
Right, how'd you know?
I'm reading this. There's your picture on the jacket. I couldn't believe it, but now I do. Would you autograph it for me?
Oh, yeah, sure.
Hey, a library book?
Well, I'll buy them a new one.
What's your name?
Susan Norton.
There.
Oh, thanks. It's awfully good.
Well, I'm glad you think so.
I loved Conway's daughter, too.
Ah, that's the minority view. Look, Susan, can I buy you an ice cream soda? I was just getting a hanker for one.
It was then in that soda parlor that I first saw Mark. To be honest, I hardly noticed him. I only had eyes for Susan. I bet you don't even remember.
Too busy with my friends. One of them was Danny Glick. Strange.
Yeah. How could we have known that in just a few weeks, our lives would all be tangled up together?
I know, that's so annoying, just because he's younger than I am.
Anyway, I got a new one, the ghoul.
Cool, what's it like?
Oh, all fangs and claws, walking through a graveyard. I haven't painted yet, but I'll need lots of red, because it's so cool. I mean,
I plan to go to New York, maybe next year.
Mm. You don't like the lot?
Mm. No, I love it. I've lived here all my life. But enough of me. How about you?
Me?
What's a big city novelist doing in the thriving community of Jerusalem's Lot? Population 1,300.
Ah. Would you believe, writing a novel?
What? Here? In the Lot?
Yeah.
What's it about? Are you gonna...
You're dripping.
Oh, thanks. Sorry. I didn't mean to pry. I'm not usually gushy.
No, no. No apologies, please. When I was a kid, I lived here. On the Burns Road. Out near Harmony Hill.
Oh, there's nothing there now but a little graveyard.
Yeah, I know. Went out to look.
Well, don't stop there. Why did you come to live in the Lot? How long were you here?
My dad died when I was 7. My mom had a sort of breakdown. While she got her act back together, she farmed me out to my Aunt Cindy. Cynthia Stones. I stayed with Aunt Cindy for 4 years. She put me on the bus back to my mother about a month after the big fire. I cried when I left the Lot.
I was born the year of the fire. Biggest damn thing that ever happened to this town, and I slept through it. Your aunt's house burnt down?
Yeah.
And now you've come back here to write a book?
Yeah.
Why?
Why? This place is my childhood, just like it's yours. That means it's haunted for me. You know, when I came back last week, I almost drove right by. I was afraid it'd be different.
Things don't change here. Not much.
So I've seen. I like that. Life got pretty hard after I left the Lot. Mom killed herself when I was 14, but most of the magic had worn off long before that. What there was here. Still here. Looking out on Joyner Avenue now, it's like looking through a thin pane of ice, like the one you can pick off the top of the town cistern in late November. Looking through that at your childhood, what you see is wavy and misty. Some places it trails off to nothing, but it's still there, most of it.
Would you like to go to a movie tonight?
Larry Crockett, real estate.
Straker.
Wait, I'm not alone. Now get yourself a cup of coffee.
I just come in.
Move your cute little butt out of here now. Oh, and get me one while you're at it. Mr. Straker. Glad to hear from you at last.
No, you're not, Mr. Crockett. Not glad, not surprised either. You got my letter?
Came last week.
You've done what I asked.
Sure, everything just like you said, Mr. Straker. Had the poster made up. Very classy. Opening in 1 week, Barlow and Straker Antiques. Browsers welcome.
You will put it up tomorrow in the window of the shop.
Consider it done.
As for the master...
I put padlocks on all the doors. Got the keys right here. Unnecessary expense, you ask me. No one goes near...
I didn't ask, Mr. Crockett. I will collect the keys this afternoon.
So you're moving in at last. Folks have been wondering...
Mr. Crockett, let me remind you of what I said at our first meeting. You will not speak of our little deal, nor of myself and my partner, Mr. Barlow. You will do as I ask, and you will keep quiet.
Mr. Straker, you're not from these parts. This isn't Boston or New York. Sure, I'll keep quiet, but folks will still talk. There's gossip already.
The ignorant tattle of the townspeople is of no consequence. Mr. Crockett, do as I ask, and you will be a very rich man.
Oh,
but
I realize
talk that. About it, and I will ruin you. Understood?
Understood. But remember, I made a condition here, too. Whatever you're doing in that house, making bombs or moonshine or $20 bills, I don't want to know. Agreed?
Agreed. See you later, Mr. Crockett.
Whew. My mama warned me about deals with the devil.
Mom, it was just great. We talked the whole afternoon. We just had so much in common.
Can I see his book? Benjamin Mears, Air Dance. Well, since I read a review of this in the Portland paper, they didn't like it much.
Well, I do. And I like him.
Maybe Floyd would like him, too. You should introduce
Mom!
Him. I just thought if you and Floyd Tibbetts are set to get married...
What in God's name gave you that idea?
I assumed...
You assumed wrong.
Susie.
I'm going up to get ready. May I have the book back, please?
I'd like to meet this Ben Mears.
I'll ask him to dinner. Tomorrow?
Okay. And where are you going tonight?
Portland. The cinema.
What should I tell Floyd when he calls?
I'm renting a third-floor cubbyhole at Eva Miller's place on Railroad Street.
That'll please my mom. Eva's highly respectable.
I tried to rent the Marsden house.
You're thinking of the wrong place.
No? Out near Harmony Hill. I saw Larry Crockett. Told me it had just been sold.
The Marston house sold?
Yeah.
Renting's crazy enough, but who'd buy the place?
Yeah, wouldn't tell me. Deep, dark secret.
That house was a wreck when I was a kid. Why did you want to stay there?
Never been inside?
No. I once looked in a window on a dare. Have you?
Once. You know the history of the house? What happened there?
Yeah, a guy called Marston had it built in the 30s.
Hubert Marston, 1928. Go on.
He was a recluse. Went soft in the head. Killed his wife and then himself, right?
More or less. You know Marston's occupation?
A retired gangster. Made his money running whiskey from Canada during Prohibition.
Yeah, I heard that story.
Isn't it true?
Could be. Seems kind of innocent, though, from what I've heard of Hubie Marston.
What have you heard?
The murder happened in the summer of 39. The mailman called Larry McLeod smelled a bad smell. Larry tried the front door, then went round the back. Luckily for him.
Why luckily?
In the kitchen, Larry found Bertie Marston, Hubert's wife. Half her head was blown away.
Oh, God.
Been dead for days. Larry fetched Norris Varney, who was constable at the time, and they, well, they went in together.
You've certainly done your homework.
There was a fortune hidden in the house.
Wow, I never heard that.
When they went into the hall, they saw how lucky they'd been. The shotgun that killed Bertie was pointing straight at the front door. It had been lashed to a chair with a string from the trigger to the doorknob. Hubie was more than just soft. He was a fully fledged loon. They found him in the bedroom at the end of the upstairs hall, dangling from a rafter.
How do you know all this?
Well, like you said, I've done my homework. I read the papers of the time, spoke to a few people.
Which people?
The mailman, Larry McLeod, and Constable Varney's widow.
This is for your book. You're writing about the Marston House, aren't you?
Yeah, no comment. Not yet, anyway.
Well, if you won't tell me that, tell me about when you went into the house. Ben?
Okay. If you really want to know, but, I don't think I can talk about that in drive. Let's find a place to pull up. When I lived in the lot, the kids I played with were all a year or two older than me. Well, they had a gang. The Red Devils. That summer, the summer I was 9, I wanted to be a Red Devil more than anything in the world. But there was a test. My test was to go into the Marston House and bring something out. You know, booty. I got in through a window. In a downstairs room, I found one of those snow globes. You know, there's a little house inside and you shake it, it snows. I should have left then, but I had something to prove. So I went upstairs to the room where Hubie hanged himself.
Oh, Ben.
Light me a cigarette, will you? I'm trying to quit, but I need one for this. I was scared witless. I didn't dare look behind in case I saw Hubie Marston shambling after me with a noose. At the top of the stairs, I got all my courage together and ran down the hall. I meant to dive into the room and grab the first thing I found and get the hell out, but the door, it was jammed. I pushed and pushed until suddenly it flew open. And there was Hubie, hanging from a beam. I could see his body outlined against the window.
Oh, Ben, don't. Oh,
Susan, it's the truth. The truth of what I saw then and what I remember 24 years on. Hubie, hanging there. Face green, eyes puffed shut, hands livid. Then he opened his eyes. You could have heard my scream for 2 miles. I ran down the stairs, out the front door, straight down the road. When I finally stopped, I saw I had the snow globe in my hand. Still got it now.
You don't really think you saw Hubert Marston, do you, Ben?
Well, I don't know. Probably I was so keyed up that I hallucinated, or maybe it's true that houses absorb the emotions that are spent in them, and they hold a kind of dry charge, and the right person, an imaginative boy, for instance, can release that charge. I don't mean ghosts. More like a kind of psychic television in 3 dimensions. I slept with the light on for weeks after that. I've dreamed about opening that door on and off ever since. Whenever I'm in stress, the dream comes.
Oh, that's terrible.
Yeah, not so terrible. We all have our nightmares. Hey, come back to Eva's and sit on the porch for a while. I can't ask you in. House rules, but I got Coke in the icebox and some Bacardi in my room if you'd like a nightcap. Here you go.
Oh, cheers. Look at the Marston House. Hmm? The lights just come on.
Oh, must be the new owner.
That's not electricity. Too yellow and faint. A kerosene lamp?
Well, they probably haven't got the power turned on yet.
Maybe. Oh, I wonder who it is.
I dare say we'll know soon. May I, join you?
Please. That was quite a story that you told me in the car.
Yeah, I suppose so.
There's nothing in your books like that. I mean, they're powerful, but there's nothing so...
morbid?
Nothing like Hubie Marston dangling from that beam. Will you come to dinner tomorrow night? My folks would love to meet you.
Oh, home cooking?
Oh, the homiest.
Oh, I'd love it. I've been living on junk food since I moved in here.
6 o'clock? We eat early in Sticksville.
Fine.
I like you, Ben.
Like you too.
I want to see you again, if you want to see me.
I do.
But go slow. Remember, I'm just a small town girl.
Am I supposed to kiss you now?
Yes. I think that comes next.
She wore blue velvet.
How's your head this morning, Weasel?
It's fine, Eva. Thanks for inquiring.
Out late again, drinking at Dell's.
Now, Ben was out late, too. I don't pick on him. With the Norton girl, right, Ben?
Yeah, no secrets in this town.
Susan Norton's real nice. Too good for Floyd Tibbetts. More coffee?
Oh, thanks, Mrs. Miller.
Come right in.
Hi, Weasel.
Oh, Mike.
Hey.
Eva?
Sit down. I'll get you some coffee. Mike, this is Ben Mears, the writer.
Mike Ryerson.
How do you do?
Mike, you okay? You look pale as death.
Weasel, I got bad news. I was just out at Harmony Hill. When I turned in the drive and got out to unlock, there was a dead dog hung head down from the gates.
Oh, my God.
I'm pretty sure it was your spike.
Oh, no. Mike, you certain?
I got him out in the pickup. Take it easy, Weasel. He don't look pretty.
How was the dog killed?
Throat slit, right there on the spot. Strung up like a steer in a slaughterhouse.
What?
When I lifted him down, I felt sick to my stomach.
What sort of pervert would do such a thing?
God knows.
More like the devil.
Yeah, Larry Crockett.
I need a service.
Straker, I was just thinking about you. Maybe I'm psychic.
You will procure a truck. Big one. Have it at Portland Docks tomorrow night.
Yeah.
Custom House Wharf with two men.
Yeah, I got that.
There are 12 boxes to be picked up. 11 are to go to the shop. The other contains a valuable sideboard, Heppelwhite. Your men will know it by its size. This box must be taken to the house.
I got it.
I want it in the cellar. Your men can enter through the outside cellar door.
Mr. Straker,
the
this side...
The padlock on the door will be left unlocked. It is vital they lock it behind them, understood?
Understood.
Follow all directions exactly.
Now, Straker, wait. Have a nice day.
This is the first time we've seen a real live author up close.
Don't worry, Mrs. Norton. I don't quote from my own works.
Hi there. Bill Norton.
Oh, hi.
Oh, I'm pleased to meet you.
Ben Mears.
I'm just fixing a barbecue.
Oh, can I help?
Why not? Come on out. Like a beer, Ben?
Oh, I'd love one. Two or three, even.
Okay, you're my man.
That's great.
Do you hear about Weasel Craig's dog?
Spike. Has he run off again? He's always doing that.
No, he was killed this morning.
Hit with a car?
No. Sacrificed.
What?
I don't know about that, Mrs. Norton.
Mike Ryerson went out to the cemetery early and found Spike hanging off the gate, ripped right open.
I heard Parkins Gillespie was of the mind that the dog had run down and a bunch of kids strung him up for a joke.
Oh, Parkins Gillespie is a fool.
Maybe so. I'll get it.
Only last week I read about devil worship in some little town in Florida. Kids broke into a church and held unholy rites.
You've been reading those papers at the supermarket checkout.
It was the Portland Herald.
One dead dog doesn't prove Satanists have come to the lot, Mrs. Norman.
So what's your explanation, Mr. Mears? Well, you're a writer. I'm sure you can come up with something. Who was it, dear?
Talk of the devil.
What?
It was Parkins Gillespie. The Glick boys have gone missing. Danny and... What's the little one called?
Ralphie.
Yeah. Went to a friend's house after school. Should have been home 2 hours ago. Mm. It seems it took a shortcut through the woods.
But there's a good pass, and the stream's almost dry.
Ah, they're probably head out somewhere smoking cigarettes. But the Glicks are worried. So Parkins has gotten a few people together. I said I'd go. Oh,
it's 20 years since I've been in those woods, but if I can help...
Attaboy. Danny! Dan! Ralphie! Ralphie! What's the time now?
Close on midnight. Looks like flashlights up ahead.
Oh, that'll be Gillespie and Tony Glegg. Park? Is that you?
Bill! Stay there. We'll come to you.
I can't figure it, man. This is the only way they could have come.
Unless they wandered off the path.
Well, why would they do that?
The kids. Maybe they went after a woodchuck. One fell, broke his leg, the other won't leave it.
Maybe.
Hey, you hear that? Mm. Sounded like an animal.
Well, that's the trouble. Wood's full of them.
Any point in searching off here?
Oh, not in the dark. Too many deadfalls. Well, Ben, take care. You'll break a leg.
Found anything, Bill?
Nothing.
Marjorie will be frantic. When I find those kids, they won't be able to sit down for a
Tony
week.
Tony Cullen. I'm sure the boys aren't to blame.
And there's something here!
Ben?
One of the boys!
Thank God.
Is he okay?
Yeah, he's out cold. I'm bringing him over. It's Danny.
Here. Lay him down on my coat.
Yeah, okay. Boy. Son, are you all right? Danny, speak to me.
Well, he doesn't seem to be injured.
Came out of the woods. God. Out of the dark. The bad thing.
What bad thing?
The boogeyman! The boogeyman.
He's not making sense.
Well, he's in shock. Something bad must have happened.
Danny, where's Ralphie? What's happened to Ralphie?
Gone! Ralphie's gone! Gone! The boogeyman got him! Ralphie's gone!
O my father, favor me now. Lord of flies, favor me now. I come to make sacrifice for your favor. I bring you reeking flesh and spoiled meat. With my left hand, I bring it to this place, consecrated in your name with the blood of a beast. Send me a sign to begin your work. I bring you this.
That's when it all started. The night Danny and Ralphie Glick went missing.
Did you know those poor boys, Mark?
They were my friends. It was my house they'd been to when they walked off into the woods.
Looking back, I guess that wasn't really the beginning. The evil in the Marston house had been there for decades, waiting for something to release it. The other evil. The greater evil.
What of the two boys?
We found Danny that night, like I said. We searched for a week for Ralphie. The police dragged the river. The volunteers combed the woods and fields. Susan, what are you doing here?
Looking for you.
Ralphie!
Dad wants you to come to dinner tomorrow night.
Oh, thanks. I'd like that.
Ralphie. Found anything?
Hmm. Oh, not a trace.
Do you think he's dead?
Yeah. I think Ralphie Glick is dead. No proof yet, but I think so.
I hope you're wrong. Mom's been sitting with Mrs. Glick. Poor woman's out of her mind. So's her husband. The other boy wanders around like a ghost. He's anemic, apparently, and they can't understand why. There are no wounds or cuts to be seen anywhere on his body. Nothing at all.
And as all this was happening, other things were going on?
Yes, Father. Bad things. Though I didn't know it then. Despite the business with the Glick boys, those first few weeks were happy. I was glad to be back in the lot, my book was going well, and there was Susan. Ironic, because it must have been about this time that Barlow slipped into the country, most likely with the help of Larry Crockett, maybe in a consignment of stuff for Barlow and Stricker's little antique shop in town.
Here they are. 12 boxes. Name of Larry Crockett. Sign here. Here's your invoice. Don't strain yourselves.
Hey, Mike, ain't that private?
We gotta make sure it's the right stuff. We screw up and Larry will tack our asses to his bulletin board.
Polish rocking chair, German clock, spinning wheels, sideboard. Jesus, Mike. Tourists. You could sell them a bag of cow shit if it was an old bag.
Hank, there's no custom stamp on this one.
Which?
The big one, the one for the Marston house. All the rest are stamped every which way. This one's clean.
For God's sake, Mike, who the hell cares? Let's just get this junk on the truck.
Cheer up, Hank. Job's half done.
Yeah, the easy half. Jeez, Mike, that old shop was spooky enough. But the Marston house?
What's wrong? Scared old Hubie will get
you? Yeah, you joke. You don't exactly look thrilled yourself.
See any lights behind them shutters?
Nope. Place is darker than the grave. Come on. Let's get that sucker out of here and down that cellar.
What's in this thing, for Christ's sake?
It's not the weight. It's this place. Take the heart out of you. I was never this scared of ma'am.
Mike, watch out!
Jesus, Hank! Pitch black, steps are slimy slick. I'm sweating like a hog. No wonder we dropped it.
Couple more steps. We're down.
That's it. I'm out of here.
Mike, wait. Larry wants it.
Larry wants it someplace he can put it there himself. Come on.
Oh, my God. Oh, no. Jesus. Mike. Mike, wait for me!
Hank, you look like someone's just giving your nuts a tweak. Here, have a shot of this.
Thanks, Larry.
Where's Mike?
Dell's getting drunk. I didn't tell him. But I gotta tell you, Larry. I can't help it. I just gotta...
Sure, Hank. Tell me everything.
I seen something down in the cellar of that house.
Yeah?
A shirt. Maybe some jeans. And a trainer. I saw a trainer, Larry.
So?
The Glick boy was wearing jeans. Read it in the ledger. Jeans, shirt, and trainers. Larry, what if the guys that bought the house and that store... What if they done for the Glick kid?
See a body down there, too?
No, Larry,
because if you did, it'd be a matter for the police. And I'd drive you right down to see Parkins this minute. But, Hank, something like this, a lot of nastiness can come up. Like that waitress Adele you've been seeing. Jackie, ain't it?
I didn't see a body.
Maybe you didn't see any clothes, either. Maybe it was just rags. An old shirt tore up for cleaning.
Sure. You got a good way of looking at things, Larry.
No, that bonus I promised you.
You didn't say nothing about
50, it. 50, wasn't it? You go to Dell's. Say hi to Mike for me, will you? Thank you for a good night's work.
Yeah, okay, sure.
See ya.
Yeah, I'll see ya.
Yeah?
Mr. Crockett?
Mr. Straker. Thought it might be you. Everything's taken care of.
Come in.
Morning, Mr. Mears. Eva told me to come up.
Constable Gillespie. It's a surprise.
Well, my wife just read your book, Air Dance.
Oh?
She's kind of shy. She thought maybe you might sign it.
My pleasure, Constable. Let's see. There you go. Though the way Weasel Craig tells it, your wife's been dead for 15 years.
Weasel say that?
Uh-huh. You're here to brace me.
I'll ask a question or two, yeah. Like, where were you the night that Ralphie Glick went missing?
From 9:30 on, I was searching the woods with you.
I was thinking of a little earlier, Mr. Mears, say, between 6 and 7.
Am I a suspect?
I ain't got no suspects. Thing like this, I'm out of my league. Catching drunk drivers out by Dell's is more my line. So, where were you?
Suppose I don't want to tell you.
I might think he had something to hide. Now, you know the older boy's dead, don't you?
Danny Glick? Mm. No. No, I hadn't heard that. When?
Early this morning. The doc out at Central Maine General said the kid was looking better, too. Got some color back in his cheeks. There's no accounting for it, is there?
I've got nothing to hide. I'm just tired of being the stranger in town. Pointed out in the street, nudged over in the library. Now you want to know if I got Ralphie Glick's scalp in my closet. Look, the night the kids went missing, I was having dinner with Susan Norton and her folks.
At the Nortons all evening, were you?
From about 7 until I got the call from the Glicks.
And before 7?
I left here around 6. Walked to the Nortons by way of Schoolyard Hill.
Well, that's a bit of a detour.
It was a fine evening. I felt like a stroll.
Anyone see you?
Well, not as far as I know.
Well, that don't clear you as well as I'd like. What are you writing about here?
Hey, none of your damn business. You keep your hands and your eyes off it, unless you got a warrant.
You're kind of touchy, aren't you, for a man who writes books to be read?
When it's in print, I'll see you get 4 signed copies. Till then, it comes under the heading of private papers.
Fair enough. For the record, I don't think he ever saw the Glick boy, but it's my job to ask.
Yeah, understood.
Mr. Mears, in a pissant little burg like Salem's Lot, you're the stranger in town till you've been here 20 years. I won't keep you from your work. I gotta make another call.
How good of you to call, Inspector.
Just plain old constable. I done it up nice, Mr. Straker.
What exactly can I do for you?
I came to welcome you to town. So how do you like that old house?
Needs a great deal of work, but my partner and I have plenty of time.
Oh, your partner around? Mr. Barlow, ain't it?
He's on a buying trip in New York. He won't be back for several days.
Is that so? What's Mr. Barlow's first name, by the way?
Court. With a K.
Well, I hope you'll both have the best of luck. And when you do see Mr. Barlow, tell him I'd like to meet him.
I shall, Constable Gillespie. He enjoys company.
Mom said Parkins Gillespie was checking up on you today.
This is a small town.
And Mom had you practically tried and convicted.
Yeah. She doesn't like me much, does she?
No. I'm sorry.
Yeah, it's okay. I got your dad on my side.
He knows class when he sees it. Ben?
Yeah?
I don't want a soda. Let's go to the park instead.
Here?
Yeah, that'll do fine.
Here, let me spread my jacket.
So, what's this new book about?
Single-minded sort of girl, aren't you?
Subject changer.
Okay, I'll tell you. Just let me think how to put it together.
Can you kiss me while you think?
Probably not. We could give it a try.
Ben.
Yeah?
Make love to me. Do you want to?
Yeah. Yeah, I want that.
Here. On the grass.
FBI Portland.
Hello there. This is Parkins Gillespie. I'm a constable at Jerusalem's Lot Township.
Uh-huh.
We got us a missing boy up here.
Ralph Glick?
That's him. That's him. Can you check on some fellas for me?
That's why we're here.
All right. Benjamin Mears. That's M-E-A-R-S. Mm-hmm. He's a writer. The other two are sort of stapled together. Kurt with a K, Barlow.
You were going to tell me about the book before we got so sweetly distracted.
Well, it is about the Mars and Mars.
I thought so. You know so much about it all, about Hoobie, about the past.
I did a lot of research.
How?
I talked to the Boston police, but mostly I talked to an old woman named Manella Corey, Bertie Marston's sister. 79 years old and sharp as a pin. Hubie was a mobster.
I told you so.
Yeah, but he didn't run liquor. He was a contract killer.
Oh, no.
Huh. In the late 20s, Hubie was arrested a few times by the Boston police for gangland killings. Never charged. The thing that finished him wasn't business at all. It was the brutal and sadistic murder of an 11-year-old boy.
Oh, Ben.
Hubie's employers got him off the hook. He moved to here. Live quietly. Or so people thought.
What do you mean?
While Hubie Marston was living in that house, 4 children disappeared. Their bodies were never found. If my book is about anything, it's about the recurrent power of evil.
You don't think that Ralphie Glick
was gobbled up by the vengeful spirit of Hubie Marston?
Something like that.
You're asking the wrong guy. Don't forget, I'm the kid that opened a door and saw Hubie hanging from a beam.
That's not an answer.
No, it's not. Come over here. You can see the house from here.
There's something about it. Chilling.
I believe that the evil man do lives on. I think that house has been sitting up there all those years, holding the essence of Hubert Marston's evil in its old moldering bones. I thought I'd come back here, maybe rent the house and, oh, I don't know, confront my own terrors, I suppose, or tap into its atmosphere and write a book scary enough to make me $1 million. Whatever, I felt I'd be in control of the situation. But now...
Now what,
Ben? Now the Marston house is occupied. A child has disappeared, and I don't know what to make of it. Maybe it's got nothing to do with that house, but I don't believe it.
What, then? Ghosts? Spirits?
Not necessarily. Maybe just some harmless guy who admired the house when he was a kid, bought it, and became, possessed.
Do you... know something about...
The new tenant? No. I'm just guessing. But if it is the house, I'd rather it was possession than... something else.
What?
Perhaps it's attracted another evil man.
You're going back to Eva's? Get on with the book?
Nah. I feel too restless. Maybe I'll drive out to that bar. What's it called?
Dell's?
Yeah, Dell's. Good night, Susan.
Is that it?
Better be it. Your mother's watching us from the window.
Ben.
Yeah.
I love you.
Ben.
Huh?
Come for a taste of the Lot's nightlife?
Hi, Weasel. I thought you might be here. I'll finish that up before it goes flat. I'll buy you another.
Good man.
Hey, Jackie. Two more buds, please.
Got us a booth at the back. Eat joiners.
Oh? Who's us?
Matt Burke. Glad to meet you, Mr. Mears.
Ben, please.
Ben writes books.
I know. I've read one of them.
Oh? Which one?
Air Dance.
I hope you liked it.
I did. Better than the critics, apparently.
Oh, ouch.
Matt teaches high school English.
Oh.
And you and him should have a lot to talk about. Now, if you'll excuse me, I gotta take a leak.
There goes the wreck of a fine man.
Yeah, I like Weasel. What happened to him?
No mystery there. The bottle got him. I understand you're writing a book about the Marston House.
Good God, who told you that?
Well, how does that old Marvin Gaye song go?
I've only told one person. I certainly didn't hear it from her. Are you psychic or have you got good spies?
Ooh, the best. Loretta Starch, a lot librarian.
Oh, yeah.
She tells me you've been scouring the Cumberland Ledger for articles on that ancient scandal. I know you're an author. I put two and two together. Jacket! That was a terrible thing. It stayed in the town's consciousness. Small towns like to hoard nastiness and scandal, of course.
Yeah, Mr. Burke?
Two more beers, please, Jackie. Oh, lovely girl. I used to teach her. Her mother, too, come to that. What was I saying?
The Marston House.
Oh, yeah. Hubie Marston's crime has left a particularly deep scar on Salem's Lot. I sometimes wonder if it's all to do with the geography.
Well, I know what you mean. The house stands on that hill overlooking the town like some kind of dark idol.
You've got it precisely. The Marston House has looked down on us all for over 50 years. On all our crimes and sins and lies. Like an idol.
Mr. Burke.
Yes, Jackie?
It's Weasel. He's passed out in the men's room. Can you come and give a hand?
Oh,
dear.
A few days later, on the first real day of fall, Danny Glick was buried in the Harmony Hill Cemetery. The tragedy that had fallen so suddenly on the Glick family, one son dead, the other still missing, was rare enough in Jerusalem's Lot to ensure that a good portion of the town turned out.
Lord God, through your mercy, those who have lived in faith find eternal peace. Bless this grave and
suffer angels shell shocked.
To watch over it. After that service, I'm not surprised.
As we bury the body of Daniel
Why
Glick,
did they do that?
Welcome him what? Into your
the
presence.
The open coffin is morbid.
And with your saints, let
Poor
him
kid looked asleep,
you forever.
Like he was going to open his eyes any minute.
Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen. Who's the
Faith
priest?
Jesus Christ, we bring
Father
the body
Callahan
of this child to be buried
from
in
St. Andrews.
He's good.
They say he likes the bottle.
Let us pray to God, who gives life to all things. We pray for our brother Daniel, to our Lord Jesus, who told us, I am the resurrection and the life. The man who believes in me shall live, even though he dies.
No!
And every
No, you ain't gonna throw dirt on my boy!
Will never suffer eternal death.
Danny! Danny, that'll
Lord,
do
you
now!
Up to the death of Lazarus, your friend.
Danny, goddammit, stop this messing around!
We ask this in faith.
Lord, hear our prayer.
You raise the dead to life. Give our brother Daniel eternal life. We ask this in faith.
Danny, you stop it now! You got your mama's skirt!
Was washed clean
Let me go!
Clean.
Let me go!
Give him
I want my boy! Danny, come out of there!
He was nourished with your body and blood.
He ain't dead! He ain't dead! He can't be!
Kingdom.
He's only 12
he
years old!
In faith.
Danny!
Lord, hear our prayer.
Danny!
You all right?
Yeah. God knows how the Glicks must feel.
Yeah. And it never goes away.
Ben, did something happen to you?
My wife was killed in a motorcycle accident 3 years ago.
Oh, Ben, why didn't you tell me before?
I don't talk about it. Maybe I should. I was driving. She was behind. We skidded on a patch of oil. I got up and walked away. She didn't.
What was her name?
Miranda.
Oh, Ben. Ben.
I meant to tell you. At the right time.
Hi, you two.
Mike. Susan. You know Mike Ryerson?
Of course.
How was the service? Guess it was a hard one.
Very hard.
You've come to fill the grave?
Yep.
Seen Hank Peters anywhere?
No, sorry.
He's supposed to be helping me. If he don't turn up, I shan't be done before dark. Say, you know who's planted there? Where you're resting?
No.
Name's almost covered. Probably ought to leave it like that.
Oh, God.
Hubert Barclay Marston, 1889 to 1939.
I must have seen that hundreds of times. Still gives me the goosebumps.
God grant he lies still.
Constable Gillespie?
Yeah.
Agent Hanrahan. I've got the information you requested. There's not much of a hook.
Just give me what you got.
Benjamin Mears, involved in a motorcycle smash in upstate New York in 1991. His wife was killed. No charges. His politics are leftish. You want details?
No. What about the other two fellas?
Kurt Barlow, British citizen, born in Germany or further east. Fled to England in the war, probably in his 70s. Dates are a little vague. Been in the import-export business in London for 30 years, most of that time with Straker. Straker seems to be the fellow who deals with the public. Barlow's rarely seen.
Oh, is that so?
Richard Throckett Straker. British by birth, 58 years old. They both applied for U.S. visas 18 months ago. That's all we've got. Except that they may be an item, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, that's about what I thought.
And no known connection between them and Mears. You need more help, just call.
Hank? Hank, that you? Come on out. Stop screwing around. God damn you, Peters. Sun's gone down and I'm still here shoveling. Look at it. Damn waste.
Are you referring to the coffin?
Jesus! What in hell are you doing, creeping up like that? Could have given me heart failure. Who are you, anyway?
My name is Barlow. I am a recent resident of your lovely town.
Guy bought the Marston house, right?
You spoke of the waste. You meant this fine casket.
Solid mahogany. And here I am, shoveling dirt onto it.
Shame.
Why not give the money to the March of Dimes or something? Do some good.
Ah, good. Everyone wants to do good. Look here at the casket. How the earth covers it like a shroud.
Jesus, thought I'd done more than that.
Beneath the earth, the lid of the coffin beneath the lid, the poor child, Daniel, with his eyes open.
What?
Gazing up at you.
No, that can't be.
Can't you feel it? Feel his gaze?
No.
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 There, the coffin. He wants you to open it. Wants you to release him.
Hey, mister, you trying to hypnotize me?
He wants to be free.
Stop it! Stop it!
Get down in the grave. Get down in the grave and free that poor child. Here, your shovel. Break it open. Daniel, welcome.